Hi everybody, and welcome back to my blog. So this week I'm going to talk about something that a listener has asked me to do. So that subject is fibroids. And lots of women suffer quite badly from fibroids. It really can be quite debilitating. So I think it's a really good topic for us to cover. So before we start, what is a fibroid? Because many people won't know if they haven't suffered. So a fibroid is a non-cancerous growth inside the uterus or womb. It's made up of muscle and fibrous tissue. It's sometimes called a leiomyoma, and there are various sizes in various locations in and around the womb, and they cause various different problems. So what causes a fibroid? So the answer to that is we're not really sure. We know that they are encouraged to grow by estrogen, one of the female sex hormones, and we know that the more estrogen a woman has, the more likely a fibroid will appear or grow. They affect women of reproductive age because that's when they have those hormones, and that's when estrogen levels are at their highest. And they shrink when estrogen is low, so after we lose our estrogen at menopause. Although having said that, now that we're using more and more HRT to treat menopause, actually the lifespan of fibroids can go on and HRT can actually encourage them to grow. So what are the symptoms? Well, it's important to know that often there are no symptoms. So we know that between 30 and 50% of women who have fibroids actually get symptoms. So that means that between 50 and 70% have them but don't have any symptoms. For 25% of women, however, when they do get symptoms, as I said, those symptoms can be really debilitating and they can include pelvic pain, really heavy vaginal bleeding, either during a period or that bleeding can just go on and on and on. So women find themselves bleeding heavily for weeks. So as a result, they can actually get quite anemic and they can have a lot of pain with that bleeding. So their periods become more and more painful, and then when they're bleeding, the pain is excruciating. They can get lower back pain. They can actually get urinary frequency, so going to the toilet to pee far more often. They can get constipation, and that's because the fibroids are so big that they're pressing on all of these other organs in the pelvis. There can be pain during sex, making sex nearly impossible. And fibroids can actually lead to infertility. So there are a lot of symptoms and they can be really far-reaching. So who's at risk of getting fibroids if some women get them and some women don't? Well, they usually develop in women between the ages of 30 and 50. But obviously, women can get them before that. So some women get them very early in their reproductive years, and some women carry on with them after 50 and long into menopause, especially if they're taking HRT. They're common. One in three women will have a fibroid. It's just lots of them don't know they have a fibroid. They're much more frequent in women of Afro-Caribbean origin. And they're also more common in women who are overweight or obese. And the reason for that is that fat cells produce estrogen, and fibroids love estrogen. They're actually estrogen driven. So if you're overweight, there's more chance of your fibroids being driven, growing, or even developing. They're less common in women who've had children, and the more children that you've had, the less chance you have of getting fibroids. So what are the types? And there are different types of fibroids. So essentially there are three different types, and this is based on where they are in your uterus or around your uterus. So these categories, main categories, and obviously there are subcategories of these, but I won't go into those today. So the first one is called intramural, and this means in the muscle of the wall, of the womb. So in the muscle that surrounds the uterus and makes it up. So these fibroids are in the wall of the uterus. These are the most common type, and they're quite often the less bothersome type. Then there's submucosal, and that means in the muscle layer beneath the inner lining of the womb, so on the very surface inside the womb, and they grow into the uterus. So they actually grow out and into the womb. So if you went inside the womb, you could see those. And then finally, there's some called subserosal, and these are outside of the womb or the uterus. So they're on the outside and they can grow really big. And of course, because they're on the outside of the uterus, they're growing into the cavity, the pelvic cavity where your uterus sits. And these are the ones that press on the bladder, the ureters, that carry the urine from the kidneys to the bladder, and the bowel, causing constipation and quite often pain. If any of these fibroids are attached to wherever they are by a stalk, so there's a little stalk before the fibroid grows, that's called a pedunculated fibroid. So those are the types. How are they diagnosed? This is always the question. Well, quite often, if they're very large, they can cause abdominal bloating, and women present to their GPs with symptoms that are being caused by these fibroids, and that, of course, then eventually, when we do our investigations, involves them being uncovered and discovered. Quite often, if you've got a very big fibroid that's growing up into your pelvis, a GP will be able to feel your tummy and will be able to feel the fibroid. And I actually diagnosed a woman, a young woman, quite recently with what felt like what I called a 16-week uterus. So a uterus that's got a baby of 16 weeks development inside it. And so I sent her for an ultrasound, and lo and behold, that's exactly what she had. Often we find them accidentally. So we send a woman for an ultrasound scan of her pelvis to see something else, maybe pain, maybe irregular bleeding, and we find the fibroids. And as I said, if we send someone for investigation for gynae problems, be that bleeding, lack of periods, pain, whatever, we find them then. If they're problematic, we then move on to other investigations, usually via gynaecology, and quite often an MRI will be done to see exactly what their size is, look at them in 3D, see if they're encroaching on other organs and how much damage they're doing in the pelvis. So the most important question then is, how do we treat them? Well, if they're found incidentally, so accidentally, we weren't looking for them and we didn't suspect they were there because they weren't causing any problems, then leave them alone. Watch and wait and see what happens, and nothing may happen. They may not grow anymore, they may never cause a problem. But if they are causing a problem, there are lots of different treatments. And those treatments are aimed at reducing the blood flow to the fibroids in the womb, pain relief, shrinking the fibroids, or removing them. And that's the broad categories of treatment. So we normally start with pain relief and reducing menstrual flow, because if we can reduce the flow, that often solves lots of the problems. So to reduce menstrual flow, we can use something called tranexamic acid. And this is a tablet that will reduce the actual flow of your period by up to 50%. So that's half. So that can be a really worthwhile exercise for many women and be enough. And you take it for 3 to 4 days when your bleeding starts. We often suggest a Mirena coil, an intrauterine system. And this stops the lining of the womb building up and therefore reduces blood flow. And that can work dramatically because in some women it stops blood flow completely. Now there are some side effects of the Mirena coil and we've talked about them before. So irregular bleeding can be a problem in the first 6 months, but it usually settles. You can get acne, breast tenderness, headaches, and some women report mood swings. All of these things usually settle. So the Mirena coil is a good solution if the fibroids are of a certain type. So what I mean by that is if they are distorting the shape of the uterus too much, then we won't be able to put a Mirena coil in. It will just be too difficult. So only certain women can have the Mirena coil as a solution. I mentioned pain relief, and these are usually non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, so ibuprofen or mefenamic acid, which you can get from your GP. And they ease pain, and they also reduce prostaglandins. And prostaglandins are the hormones around the uterus at the time of our period, and actually when we're in labour, that produce the pain. So we can reduce those to stop the pain, and that also sometimes reduces the bleeding as well. It can be taken with tranexamic acid, so quite often we give both. And there are some side effects, but they're not massive. And there can be stomach upset and diarrhea. The contraceptive pill can be a good solution because it can ease the bleeding, regulate the bleeding, and ease the pain. Progesterone, taken orally, so by mouth, can thin the lining of the womb and reduce bleeding and therefore pain. You take it on days 5 to 26 of your normal menstrual cycle. Side effects with this, as with all tablets, are weight gain, bloating, breast tenderness and acne. But again, these usually settle after the first few months, so that can be a good solution. Injectable progesterone, so we call this a depot, that you have once every 12 weeks, also thins the lining of the womb and helps reduce bleeding and pain. Side effects with that one are weight gain, irregular bleeding, absent periods, which can be a real bonus, and premenstrual symptoms like bloating, fluid retention, breast tenderness, but again, they can settle. The only thing to remember about the depot injection is that if you are looking to get pregnant, it can delay your fertility by up to 12 months. So it's worthwhile thinking about that. So the next step, if none of those are working, is to try and shrink a fibroid. And we have a medication to do that called gazelarin. And it is a gonadotropin releasing hormone analog. You need a referral to gynecology for this. This can't be done by your GP. Whereas all of the others that I spoke to you just now can be done by your GP. It works on the pituitary gland, which is in the brain, and it stops the hormones being sent to the ovaries to actually produce estrogen, and it actually brings the menstrual cycle to a halt. So it's sometimes used prior to surgery because if we starve the fibroids of estrogen, they shrink. So it can be good to shrink them so that your surgery is least invasive as possible because the fibroids are as small as possible before we take them out. There are big side effects to this drug. So you actually go into a menopause, a chemical menopause, so you can experience the hot flushes, the sweating, the vaginal dryness, the muscle aches, the mental fogginess, everything. And sometimes gynae will use a low dose HRT to actually try and help with those symptoms. Osteoporosis is also a risk. You only use it for 6 months and you get a full return to fertility when you stop using it. So it's important to know that it's a short-term solution which can have big side effects, but they only last while you're on it. Now, there was a medication called ulipristal acetate. You may have heard of it, and it is still being used and it is still on the NHS website. However, we're not using this anymore for new patients, so you won't be offered this anymore because there have been some severe cases of liver failure. So women who are still on it, don't panic. Speak to your doctor or your gynae. You should be having monthly liver function tests just to make sure that everything is okay. And there's more research being done into this at the moment. So if you're on it, it's fine. You need close monitoring, but it won't be started at the moment. The jury is still out on this one. And then there's surgery. So surgery is for severe symptoms that are just making life intolerable and if other treatments have failed. And there are several methods used and you'll decide with your surgeon which one is best for you. So a myomectomy is where we actually take away the fibroids. We go in either via an open cut in the tummy or via keyhole surgery and we take the fibroids out of the wall of the uterus or off of the wall. It's not suitable for everyone. You do need a general anaesthetic and a short hospital stay, and there is a chance that the fibroids might grow back. You can have what's called a hysteroscopic resection. So a small camera and tools are inserted into the vagina, then through the cervix and then into the womb. Several insertions like that are needed as we keep going in and cutting away, burning away the fibroids. And it's suitable for those submucosal ones, the ones that I said to you could see if you went into the womb. And it does preserve fertility, so that's quite often the reason that it's used. Usually it's done under a general anaesthetic, sometimes under a local anaesthetic. You do go home the same day. You can get cramps and very light vaginal bleeding, which stops within a few weeks. There's a new process now which is being used. Similar, goes in through the cervix into the womb, and it's called a morcellator. The benefit of this is that there's only one insertion through the cervix, and it minimises any chance of damage to the womb or the neck of the womb, so that if you do want to go on for pregnancy, you keep those risks as low as possible. There isn't much evidence for it at the moment because it's quite new and it's not offered everywhere, but it is something worthwhile talking about to your gynae if that's the stage that you're at. And then finally, probably the most dramatic, is a hysterectomy. And this is where we take away the uterus or the womb completely. So we remove the source of the problem. You would only use this if your family is complete, because you would not be able to go on to have children. But it is the most effective long-term solution. And I've done a vlog on hysterectomy, so if you want more information about that, just have a look at that vlog. It's done through the vagina or an open cut in the tummy or through keyhole surgery. It's done under a general anaesthetic or a spinal anaesthetic. It can push you into early menopause if the ovaries are taken or affected. But estrogen-only HRT can be used, although sometimes this can refeed fibroids. So this is another discussion with your gynae. There are some non-surgical options. So there's one called uterine artery embolisation. So this is where we block the artery that's feeding the fibroids and hopefully they will shrink. So a radiologist does this, and he does it under imaging so he can see what he's doing, and a dye is injected via the leg. A local anaesthetic is used. There's a very short hospital stay. We don't know about the effects on fertility with that one, I'm afraid. There isn't enough evidence. You can have endometrial ablation. This is where we remove the lining of the womb so that it can no longer build up and no longer bleed. So it treats heavy bleeding. We use a heated wire, loop wire, or hot fluid inside the uterus, or a laser. It's done under local or general anaesthetic. You can get vaginal bleeding and cramp for up to 4 weeks. And it's not recommended if your family is not complete, because we can't guarantee whether or not a pregnancy would be sustainable in the future. There are some newer techniques now under MRI, but they are very new. So there's MRI-guided transcutaneous focused ultrasound. There's MRI-guided percutaneous laser ablation of fibroids. So this is needles into the fibroids under an MRI guidance, and either a laser or ultrasound beam is passed into the fibroid in order to kill it and to shrink it. It's not suitable for all fibroids, and at the moment, again, the long-term effects are not known. There isn't enough evidence, especially on women who want to have pregnancies in the future. So the jury is still out on this one, and it's not widely available at the moment, only in certain hospitals. So are there any alternatives? Well, there are lots that are suggested, and I can't vouch for them because there is no evidence. But the kind of things that I've read up about are decreasing inflammatory foods, so cutting out caffeine, alcohol, processed food, decreasing environmental hormones, so red meat and dairy that's got estrogen hormones inside them so as not to feed the fibroids. Increasing anti-inflammatory foods, so whole fiber, leafy green vegetables, supplements, organic foods. So basically a healthy lifestyle. Essential oils are out there to try and treat fibroids. Acupuncture has been used, and there is a lot of evidence behind acupuncture, but not in particular to fibroids, but certainly it's something worth considering. Exercise is essential for all pelvic issues and pain. And hormonal approaches. So there are doctors out there who use bioidentical hormones to treat all pelvic problems in women. And again, I don't have the evidence for this, but they feel that if you balance up the hormones, instead of being an estrogen-driven environment, a balance will actually help shrink the fibroids. So as I said, I don't have evidence for those, but I will put a link to a natural site. I can't vouch for the validity of the site either, but I will put it in afterwards, because I think it's always, you know, my aim is to give you the options so that you can do your own research. I will put some information about the different solutions that I've suggested today that are available on the NHS and the NHS website on fibroids. So I hope that's helped. It is a big topic that we've rushed through. Don't forget to look at the hysterectomy one if that's something you're considering. And hopefully this will enable you to ask me any questions afterwards, as always, and I will answer them to the best of my knowledge, and at least arm you with the information that you need to go to your doctor to discuss your individual issues. So as ever, thank you so much for watching, and don't forget to ask me questions or suggest future topics. See you soon.